this session will be on flipped classrooms. So, I require all of you to listen to the videos first, because there is going to be an activity that follows this immediately. So, this is video number 1.
So, what is flipped classroom? Just to recap, flipped classroom is one way to ensure that class time is spent in assimilation rather than information transmission. So, the instructor typically finds or creates videos on the topic, and students watch these videos before coming to the class, and then the class time is spent in activities and discussion. So, this is the important part of the flipped classroom model, where the class time is spent in activities and discussions. See, often even when we say that, look, I want my students to understand this topic deeply, what essentially we mean as instructors is that we want the student to acquire some level of mastery beyond recall and comprehend levels. So, what we would also as teachers be happy with is to help students assimilate the information and to get them to attain that level of mastery. So, that is what the class time in a flipped classroom is spent on, rather than simply in information transmission. So, that is the key difference between the traditional model and the flipped classroom model. Okay, so before we go much farther into what exactly is a flipped classroom, let us just get an idea of what these videos look like. So, what sort of videos do instructors create? Typically, videos are 10 to 20 minute lectures on one concept. Okay. So, videos may include slides, they may include audio, they may include some annotation, they may include writing on a tablet or screen capture of an application. Okay. There are many, many such videos that can be seen on the web. So, here are some sites.
Okay, that was video 1, in which Professor Sridhar Iyer was explaining what is a flipped classroom. So, now you are actually going to be in a flipped classroom, where you are going to watch a video about a simple concept, which I believe everyone will be familiar with, is the Pythagoras theorem. The video is from Khan Academy. So, I am posted the video URL in the chat. I am going to play the video now.
Welcome to the presentation on the Pythagorean theorem. We will now teach you about the Pythagorean theorem. And you might have heard of this before. As far as I know, it is the only mathematical theorem named after the founder of a religion. Actually, Pythagoras, I think his whole religion was based on mathematics, but I'm no historian here, so I'll leave that to the historians. But anyway, let's get started on what the Pythagorean theorem is all about. If I were to give you a triangle, and I were to tell you that it's not a normal triangle, it is a right triangle. And all a right triangle is a triangle that has one side equal to 90 degrees. And I'll leave you to think about whether it's ever possible for a triangle to have more than one side that's 90 degrees. But anyway, just granted that a right triangle is a side that has at least, well, let me just say, a right triangle is a triangle that has only one side that's at 90 degrees. And if you have a right triangle, what the Pythagorean theorem allows you to do is, if I give you a right triangle and I give you two of the sides, we can figure out the third side. So before I throw the theorem at you, let me actually give you a couple of more definitions. Actually, just one more. So if this is the right angle in a right triangle, it's at 90 degrees, and we symbolize that by drawing the angles like this, kind of like a box, instead of drawing it like a curve like that. Hope I'm not messing up the drawing too much. The angle opposite the right angle, the side opposite the right angle, is called the hypotenuse. And I really should look up where this word comes from, because I think it's a large and unwieldy word, and it's a little daunting at first. My sister told me that she had a math teacher once who made people memorize, it's a high pot that is in use. So I don't know if that helps you or not. But over time, you'll use the term hypotenuse so much that it'll seem just like a normal word, although when you look at it, it really does look kind of strange. Anyway, going back to definitions, the hypotenuse is the side opposite the 90-degree angle. And if you look at any right triangle, you'll also quickly realize that the hypotenuse is the longest side of the right triangle. So I think we're done now with definitions. So what does the what does the Pythagorean theorem tell us? Well, let's call C is equal to the length of the hypotenuse. Length of hypotenuse. And let A be the length of this side. And let B equal the length of this side. What the Pythagorean theorem tells us is that A squared plus B squared is equal to C squared. Now that very simple formula might be one of the most powerful formulas in mathematics. From this, you go into Euclidean geometry, you go into trigonometry, you can do anything with this formula. But we'll leave that to future lectures. Anyway, let's actually test this formula. Or not test it, let's use the formula. Maybe in another presentation I'll actually do a proof, or at least minimum a visual proof of it. I apologize ahead of time that I'm a bit scatterbrained today. It's been a while since I left a video, and once again, I told you I sang a little bit too much last night, so my throat is sore. Okay, so we have a triangle. And remember, it has to be a right triangle. So let's say that this is a right angle right here. It's 90 degrees. And if I were to tell you that this side is of length 4, and actually, let me change that. This side is of length 3. This side is of length 4. And we want to figure out the side of this length. So the first thing I do when I look at a right triangle is I figure out what the hypotenuse is. Which side is the hypotenuse? Well, there's two ways to do it. Actually, there's actually one way. You look at where the right angle is, and it's the side opposite to that. So this is the hypotenuse. This would be C in our formula, in the Pythagorean theorem. I mean, we could call it whatever we want, but just for simplicity, you remember A squared plus B squared is equal to C squared. So in this case, we see that the other two sides, each of them squared, when they add it together, will equal C squared. So we get 3 squared plus 4 squared is equal to C squared, where C is our hypotenuse. So 3 squared is 9 plus 16 is equal to C squared. 25 is equal to C squared. And C could be plus or minus 5, but we know that you can't have a minus 5 length in geometry. So we know that C is equal to 5. So using the Pythagorean theorem, we just figured out that if we know the sides, if one side is 3, the other side is 4, that we can use Pythagorean theorem to figure out that the hypotenuse of this triangle, it has the length 5. Let's do another example.
So I hope most remote centers have viewed the video right now. So I'll take this video as the starting case for starting the flip classroom. So consider a scenario where two teachers, A and B, for the given topic Pythagoras theorem, they are taking classes in their respective school. Teacher A gives a lecture on the topic Pythagoras theorem, where he or she explains to the class what the individual sides and hypotenuse are, and it is a traditional lecture. Whereas teacher B asks the students to watch this Khan Academy video at home before coming to the class and does problem solving activities in the class. Like problem solving activities as in real life examples. So what will be the height of the shadow of a tree? So those kind of examples. You now to do is make two groups A and B. So the participants in group A will debate for the notion that teacher A's strategy is better than teacher B. And those in group B will say that the teacher who showed the Pythagoras theorem and then did real life examples in classroom is showing a better teaching methodology. So coordinators, at the end of the debate, you will have to send us 2 points in favor of teacher A and teacher B. So this time you should spend in grouping yourself and debating the points, lots of messages in the chat. So the idea that we have to do is you have to group yourself into two groups. In group A, you vote for a teacher who takes Pythagoras theorem in the traditional style, and in group B, you will vote for a teacher who is showing this Khan Academy video to the students before coming to the class and does problem solving activities inside the class. And you will have to come up with 2 points in favor of both. The RC coordinator has to come up with 2 points which group A and group B said in favor of their respective teachers at the end of this. You have 10 minutes for this particular activity. So I am getting lots of answers from the remote centers. I'll just mention one or two right now. So people who are in favor of group A, they are saying that, so this is from IPS Academy Indore, it is better because group A is better because it is cost effective and problem is solved using chalk and talk. Dr. Mahalingam College of Engineering and Technology Pollachi, they says that face to face interaction is there, hence teacher A is better. For Jayalakshmi Institute from Dharmapuri, the teacher A group says that class will be a live one and student will be able to clarify the doubt immediately and student may have wide concept knowledge. Okay. So there is more on the interactive, and so there is a drawback which is posted, which says that traditional method is time taking and it takes more time in teaching. So there is the group B from Indore, they say that understanding becomes easy in case of teacher B. So again, teacher B, they say that there are options wherein they say that they'll be able to clarify more real life problems inside the class. Concept will be easily cleared. For group B, teaching becomes more pleasant. Teacher B is more student centric. Students with different learning abilities can study on their own pace for teacher B. It's good that most of you have identified some of the important benefits and limitations of both the teachers. So I'll just summarize this particular activity.
Okay, so let me just try to summarize. I mean, most of your points actually fall largely within this idea of, for teacher A, there are two perspectives that we want to look at it from. So one perspective is that the teacher's perspective itself, wherein what we want to say is that the teachers can adapt the lecture dynamically to the student's response. So that what we are saying as immediate clarification, all of those things are possible. And then from the student's perspective again, the advantage seems to be that the student can ask questions to the teacher, the student can see the teacher in the classroom. All of those seem to be the advantages of the teacher A model. However, the key drawback here is that the student does not have access to the teacher while working on the problems at home. Okay. So here there is an important point to keep in mind, that is, we become experts only when we do things, right? We don't become experts by hearing things. So in order to develop expertise or mastery in a subject, it's necessary for the students to practice and it's necessary for the students to actually do something with the material that the teacher is saying. So, and that activity happens in the at home, and at this point the student does not have access to the teacher. So also the teacher does not know what difficulties the students face while doing the problem solving. Okay, on the other hand, now let's look at teacher B. So from the teacher B's perspective, you're having the video at home and exercises are being done in class. Now what happens is, from the teacher's perspective, the teacher can address students' problem solving difficulties in the class itself. So it's not difficulties with respect to understanding of the topic, it's not at the recall or the understand level, but it's at the apply and the higher levels. Difficulties that arise at that level can be addressed by teacher B in the class. The advantage for the students again is that the students can watch the lecture video at their own pace, So if they want to repeat, if they did not understand something, they can go back and get that. Or, and the second thing is, when they are in class, they can get immediate help from peers and the teacher during the problem solving process. So this is the advantage from the student's perspective. Also, this, there are some points which are common in both the cases. For example, there is a point which one of the centers is saying that there is eye-to-eye contact between the student and the teacher, that is important. And what you can see is that it's possible in both the modes. It's possible for teacher A also to have this eye-to-eye contact, as well as for teacher B to have the eye-to-eye contact. So essentially what is happening is that the total amount of time of the study is remaining the same, and the difference is in what students do in class versus what students do at home.
Is that teacher B can also create interactive sessions within the classroom and make the classrooms more lively, and there will be more real life applications which the students are targeting within the classroom, which in turn will enable them to target higher order thinking skills within the classroom. So with this, I first state the learning objectives of this particular session. At the end of this session, you will be able to describe what is flipped classroom and its advantages, and also identify some active learning strategies to effectively integrate flipped classroom in your teaching. Following this class session, there will be a lab with guidelines to create videos for a flipped classroom, and within this lab, you will design active learning strategies for your course while teaching with flipped classroom videos. So now play the second video.
State guidelines to create videos, and you will be able to create videos, as well as you will be able to design active learning strategies for your course. So that will happen in the lab, which follows immediately after the session. So let's try to reflect about what happens in a typical traditional classroom. So in such a classroom, what happens during class is mostly information transmission. Information transmission means the instructor is giving a lecture and students are taking notes. Sometimes the instructor may ask questions to which students respond. Sometimes the students ask questions to which the instructor responds. Okay, and what is happening outside the classroom is the activity of assimilation, or the students getting some mastery over the content. Okay? And this is done by the instructor giving problem sets and assignments, which students have to solve and submit. And now students may work individually or work in groups. Okay, so I'll pause here for a minute for you to reflect upon what are the limitations, what might be the limitations of such a classroom. Okay, so having given you 1 minute to reflect, so let us look at some limitations. There are some centers which are still sending in the limitations. It's very encouraging that many of the limitations that you are sending in are actually matching with the limitations that I have listed on this slide. So let's just quickly look at these limitations. Okay? So during class, when there is the information transmission that happens, the instructor is lecturing. So often as instructors, we think that we are the ones who are most excited about our content, right? I mean, even right now, I am speaking and I am excited about saying this. I don't know how many of you are actually listening to me, right? So that is one reason that students don't pay utmost attention to the instructor's lecture, okay? However good it may be. And the second thing is students assume that they can understand because they can follow the lecture. So this is a big drawback with the lecturing model. And even if we improve on lecturing by having some interactivity such as instructor asking questions, often what happens is that these questions are answered only by a few students, typically who are the high achievers or the toppers of the class, and others are left behind. On the other hand, when students ask questions, often these questions are also asked only by a few students, and sometimes the instructor makes the assumption that because a few students have understood and have asked some advanced questions, the entire class is able to follow at that level, and so the instructor sometimes unwittingly goes ahead with the material when a large part of the class has not been able to keep up, has not been able to apply the learning that has been transmitted in that particular session. So that is one limitation of the traditional classroom from the during class perspective. If you look at the limitation of the traditional classroom from the outside the class perspective during the assimilation phase, so now the instructor feels that, okay, I have given problem sets and I have given assignments to the students, and if they do these problems and assignments, then they will attain mastery over the content. So now what may happen is that these problem sets and assignments may be too challenging for some students. On the other hand, they may be too simple or boring for other students. In both cases, students may lose interest in solving these problems, and the instructor often does not come to know which student is having what type of difficulty. So instructor does not know which are the students who have found it challenging, instructor does not know which are the students who have found it boring. Okay. So it can possibly lead to copying of the answers. Okay. So the second reason is that students study individually or in groups, and this typically happens just before the assignment submission deadline or the exam, which may cause students to focus on the assessment and not on the concept mastery itself. So again, most of us are familiar, you know, most of us often say that, you know, students study only at the last minute. So considering that perspective, what is likely to happen in a traditional classroom is that even though the instructor has given a lot of problem sets and assignments for the students to practice, all of this practice often for a majority of the students gets postponed to a few days before the exam, right? That's a very common phenomenon that we observe in our classes. So there will be those students who do it very diligently early, and there will be some students who will never do it. Both extremes are there, but for the large part, the students will do it only when there is some forcing function such as a submission deadline or an exam. So the drawback of doing that is that the students' focus at that point, because of the deadline, is on the assessment and it's not on the concept attainment. So these are the two major limitations of the traditional classroom. Okay, so what is this flipping the classroom? Okay, flipping the classroom is simply about going from information transmission in the class and assimilation outside the class, which is the traditional model, to saying that let us move this information transmission to outside the class and let us move this assimilation to inside the class. So the reason for doing this, moving the information transmission to outside the class, is that with the help of technology, it's easy to capture this information transmission. And we can let students work on the lower cognitive levels, such as what is the definition of something, explain how something else works, explain the process of some other system. All those level of concepts can be worked on by looking at the information transmission. And the higher order concepts or higher order cognitive levels, they can be dealt with in class, which is where the students have the difficulty. So the key idea of a flipped classroom is, so this is the flip that is happening. Information transmission, instead of happening in class, that is moved to outside class, and assimilation, instead of happening outside class, is moved to the in class. So this is the main crux of the flipped classroom idea.
So in this video, you saw Professor Sridhar explaining what are the limitations of a traditional classroom and what are the advantages that you get when you actually flip the classroom in the right way. So with this, I just move on to the next video. So now it is about flipped classroom and active learning. Just listen to what Professor Sridhar Iyer have to say about this.
I mean, I'm sure you all have seen such videos on the net, and the key idea about a flipped classroom video is such a video is created very specifically for a short duration. So about 10 to 20 minutes, or maybe sometimes even a 5-minute video, or rarely beyond 20-minute videos. Okay, so that is a flipped classroom video, and in that one concept is explained, the basic idea, like what we just now saw, was the basic idea of the Pythagoras theorem of a square plus b square is equal to c square, where a and b are on the two sides. Okay, so that's what happens in the video. And then what happens in the classroom itself is again an interesting point. Now, the content that the students have watched is given some context. So, often in the classroom, the instructor will pick up some real world scenario. So, for example, if you were the instructor, you might pick up an actual a building whose height you want to estimate, or some such mechanism, some such real world scenario wherein you want to apply the Pythagoras theorem in order to solve a problem. Okay? So, as a result of which, students are now actively engaged in problem solving and critical thinking beyond the traditional course. Okay? So, the students are not coming to your classroom to hear you say that a square plus b square is equal to c square. On the other hand, students are coming to the classroom to work out problems which deepens their understanding of the Pythagoras theorem. So, what do we mean by deepens the understanding is that they are able to apply it in various scenarios, they are able to analyze a problem and see whether it is a problem for Pythagoras theorem and so on. So, the other advantages of flipped classroom activities are that students are now encouraged to ask exploratory questions and delve beyond the core curriculum. And they can be transformed from passive listeners to active learners. So, this is the big advantage. And why is this a big advantage? Because we already know, we have seen in the previous sessions, that active learning has great deal of benefit. So, just to recall, what is active learning? In active learning, the instructor creates carefully designed activities that require students to talk, write, reflect and express their thinking. And students go beyond listening, copying of notes and execution of prescribed procedures. So, students actually take ownership of their learning. And we know that the benefits of active learning are that students are actively engaged with the content and learn from each other. It builds a friendly yet academic atmosphere in the classroom. And most importantly, it includes all the students in the teaching learning process and not just those students who are highly self-motivated or who are high achievers in that particular classroom. So, the key idea of flipped classrooms and active learning is that a classroom with instructor and peers present is more useful for students to apply their learning rather than listening to information transmission and asking clarifications. So, the point here that is being made is that it is not that information transmission is not important. Information transmission is also important, but the time that the student spends with the instructor and the peers is better spent in students learning to apply the knowledge that they have gained in the information transmission than rather than simply listening to the information transmission. Okay? So, the important thing is in a flipped classroom, the in-class time can be devoted to tasks that promote active learning. Since this information transmission part of the class happens before the students come to the class. Okay, so, let us ask the question, the next obvious question that we would have in our minds is that, okay, it is all fine, does it really work? So, the key idea here again is that there are many studies that establish the benefits of active learning strategies. Now, what is a flipped classroom? Flipped classroom is nothing but a student doing some activity outside of class, student doing some preparatory activity such as watching a video or reading some material and doing a lot of active learning on that material in the class. So, as a result of which, the flipped classrooms that incorporate active learning automatically get the benefits of these active learning strategies. So, there are many papers on these strategies. One of them is as far back as 2001. The idea of flipped classroom with peer instruction showed that students who worked in that model had significant learning gains compared to traditional instruction. And then there were other research work, controlled group studies, which showed that flipping the classroom with small group discussions can also produce significant learning gains. So there are gains not only in terms of student learning, that students learn better and they are able to perform better in the exams, but also there are gains in terms of students are more interested in the topic, students come to class, and all those other advantages are also been documented. Okay, so to summarize what we have seen so far, why is flipped classroom a good idea? Because the class time is spent in assimilation rather than information transmission. Secondly, because the class time is spent in the higher cognitive levels of apply, analyze and create on that topic rather than lower levels of recall and understand. And third, the support of peers and the instructor is available to the student while they are working on these higher cognitive levels. So if there is a doubt or if there is some clarification or if there is some quick conception that needs to be corrected, all of that can happen while the student is working on these problems or on these activities which are targeting the higher cognitive level.
So now you have listened to considerable length of information transfer from our end. So now we will try to do one active learning strategy with you. So we are going to do a think pair share. So the question is, just see the question. Suppose your institute made it compulsory for you to use the flipped classroom mode. So you have to think that tomorrow your principal or your head of institution is coming and telling you that from next week onwards all our classrooms will be in flipped mode. So now what he asks you to do is find videos and make sure the class is in flipped mode and students are able to see the videos from home. And apparently you found an excellent video on your own topic and asked your students to watch it before class. So in the think phase, what I want all of you to do is, what will you do in class most of the time? Write down your individual answer, and your answer should not be just like, I will do problem solving, I will do think pair share, I will do peer instruction. It should be very specific as to what you are going to do and what your student is going to do. So let's say in think phase I will pose this question, in pair phase I will make them do a particular activity so that students will be engaged. So we want details to that level. So I repeat, in the think phase, write individually what you are going to do in your in-class segment of flipped classroom. So now we will move to the pair phase. So in pair phase, you have to examine your neighbor's answer and you will have to see whether his explanation helps students to work on higher cognitive levels inside the class. If not, what you have to do is together make both your answers more specific so that your strategy develops the higher order cognitive levels for your students. So which means you and your neighbor who will be working in similar domain will have to specify even more minutely how good your strategy is going to be. So you can take 5 minutes to do this particular task. So work in pairs. You need not share the answers right now. There will be an explicit share phase. Answers like explanation with analogical examples and problem solving, these are at a broader level even at this stage. Supposing your topic is computer programming and you have let's say the idea of teaching identifiers to your students. So you should specify it to that extent that I am going to take identifier, I am going to take the analogy of my name, then I am going to explain what an identifier is. So it is to that level that we want specificity at the pair phase. So this is an answer from RC1206. I would really appreciate this answer because he has actually given steps. He'll first give algorithm to solve the problem, compare algorithm with your neighbor, and finally write the program. It was present in the TPS activity constructor, I mean, I should credit the teacher who said this because he knew what he has to do inside the class. So what I am looking at is this much specificity when it comes in the pair phase. So people who say open problem solving, mini projects, you will have to be more specific, because even at this level, you are still going to say at the topmost level that I am going to do this. Again, another, I think this is from Noida, CDAC. So topic is artificial intelligence. In think, I am going to illustrate the working principle of chatbot and say my students to write algorithms for it, which is decent. So now I see that you should have got an idea about what this is. So in the share phase, what you have to do, so you are sending us the chats, which is really good, but within your center, take 5 minutes to share your answer with your colleagues, and the RC can keep on posting those answers via chat, and we'll tell some of the interesting ones through our video. So in the share phase, within your RC, share your answers about how you are going to be very specific about in-class activity of your flipped classroom. One hint that I can give is you can use your own TPS activities or PI activities that you have created across the past 2 days. So I am seeing more and more specific answers. So RCs, you can continue posting those. So let me highlight this answer from NMIMS Shirpur, Dhule. In the think phase, they are going to ask the students to identify the causes of vibrations in practical scenario, which means they would have already seen a video on vibrations. So individually, now they have to think about the causes of these vibrations. In the pair phase, they are asked to discuss the ways in which it can be eliminated. In the share phase, okay, it is lost somewhere in the chat, but I think in the share phase, you are going to discuss or look at, collect a list of all the different ways in which students have tried to solve the problem of vibrations. Very good strategy. This is a non-computer one, so that's why I highlighted it, because these examples were not there in the think, pair, share constructor, which I am pretty sure. So let's look at the solution given by Siddhaganga Institute of Technology. Topic is finite state machine in real time. Example is, in real time, example is given and asked to write the state diagram and BSDL code for it, which means that students are now deeply involved in higher order thinking skills, where they have to analyze the real time example, then create its state diagram, and then apply it to write the BSDL code for that particular real time example. So this is the type of higher order thinking skills that you need to make sure that your students are able to do inside the class the moment you are going to flip it. So now we will move to the next video.
Let's look at two examples. So this is an example from two courses that I have taught. So in a course on computer programming, where the topic was arrays, the pre-class activity that the students had to do was to watch a video that defines an array. What is an array? So the video basically says that an array is nothing but a collection of elements, and this is the way to define an array in C++. And then it shows C++ examples on using arrays. Okay, so simple examples of how arrays can be declared in a program and how they can be used in a program. So that is the pre-class activity which does this video. Very similar in idea to the Khan Academy video that we saw. And then the in-class activity were of two types. Okay. One type was to give a worksheet which has problems or programs using arrays. Now for some of these programs, the program was given and the students had to predict the output. Okay. So in some cases, so there are three typical ways in which computer programming can be encouraged. So one is by asking students to predict the output of some program. In another case is to asking students to debug a given program. And in the third case is by asking them to write programs. So what we did was to have students predict the output of some of these programs, then debug other programs, and also insert missing code into the programs. So what this worksheet actually did for the student was that instead of simply knowing the topic of arrays in theory and having seen some examples of arrays, they now actually worked with programs in the class, and wherever they got stuck, they could simply raise their hand and either a TA or the instructor or one of their peers would be available in order to clarify the point at which they were stuck. So that was actually a good session for the students, because they were actually working with the content and not simply listening to the content. The second in-class activity that we did was getting them to write think-pair-share activity to write a program to sort the array. So for example, in the think phase, all that the students had to do was to come up with some pseudocode idea of how will I sort 10 numbers. Suppose 10 numbers are given, what is the mechanism that I will use in order to sort those 10 numbers. So those 10 numbers are the array. Then in the pair phase, the students can go on to work with a partner to write the C++ code for sorting their numbers. And in the share phase, they can go on to looking at comparing their program with the instructor's program to sort the array. So that was the think pair share activity for this flipped classroom. Here is another example. This is an example from another course called Communication Networks, and the topic was IP addressing. Okay, so the topic of IP addressing once again is a topic which I used to find a little, had a lot of information transmission in it. So the pre-class activity here was that they simply watched a video that described the basic mechanism for assigning IP addresses in a network. Okay. So the pre-class activity was simply watching the video, and all that the video contained was that there are different classes of IP address. There is a class A, there is a class B, and there is a class C, and so on. Okay. Now, subsequently, when they came to class, they did not need to be described what these various types of IP addresses are, and so they could simply directly go on to peer instruction questions on the IP address classes. So you could give an IP address and ask them to identify whether it's a class A or a class B or a class C, or you could ask them to write the how does a class A address look. So questions of that sort could be dealt with in the classroom. The second such activity that they could do was a debate on the pros and cons of hierarchical addressing. So the way the internet addresses are set up, is that a good way? Is there a better way to do the addressing of computers? Was another debate that they could do. And the third activity that they did in the classroom was to design solutions to reduce the inefficient use of address space. So sometimes the IP address space gets wasted because of one organization being allotted more IP addresses than it actually requires. And so the students themselves had to think of ways in which these inefficient use of this address space can be reduced. And then all that I had to do as the instructor was to point out that each of these solutions that the students came up with were nothing but the names of some of the efficiency increasing mechanisms that were already there in the internet. Okay, and the details of those mechanisms then made the content for the next flipped classroom.
Got an interesting chat message from Padma Prasad Singha University, Bhattewar. So apparently somebody has already made this video and he has actually shared it to us, which is very good. I hope you have done some amount of active learning strategies, though it might be informal, but your effort is truly appreciated, and we hope that you get involved more in these upcoming sessions within your remote center, and also help participants in the forums and wiki when they have doubts regarding flipped classroom. Yeah, so before moving to the activity, what you have to understand is a flipped classroom is not just instructor simply creating lecture videos and students watching it, or instructor simply clarifying whatever is the concept within the class. Rather, there has to be proper planning both inside and outside the classroom, and the instructor needs to create structured learning activities within the in-class segment also, where students will be involved in higher order thinking. So there has to be some planning to the out of class segment. I'll just post a poll right now.
Let me just add a few words here. Some of you may be wondering that, you know, we are running this session mostly through videos which have been created earlier, and where is the instructor and all that. So this has been done very deliberately. The reason is there is a lot of thought has gone into, first of all, creating the videos and then the sequence in which they have been played and all that, so that any of you can take these videos and run them in your own colleges for your own colleagues, like what Jay Krishnan is doing right now. He's simply taken the videos, he's added his own explanations wherever required, and he's able to run the session. So this is basically a live demonstration for you of how effective a flipped classroom can be, given the videos that has been created by somebody else and the activities which have also been specified. All that you would need to do in order to run the flipped classroom is to execute as per what is told in the activities. So that is the reason why we have run this session this way, and we hope that you are able to also feel the confidence that you can repeat this for your colleagues about what is a flipped classroom and how to create activities for a flipped classroom using the videos that are already posted on the YouTube channel. So Jay Krishnan has also done the effort of chunking the videos into appropriate segments and sequencing them. Yeah, so now the poll is ready, so you can just take a look at the questions. So there are four options here. The question is that a teacher should implement a flipped classroom because, and there are four options. The first option is that the teacher has to lecture for less time. The second option is that the student can watch the video just before the exams, so it will help the student to revise. The third option is that the student is engaged with higher cognitive level activities. And the fourth option is that teacher can answer specific doubts of students. Okay, now note that all four are valid options. All of them are correct options. So what you are required to identify is which is the best option for which the flipped classroom is suitable. Okay, and we have already about 68 centers which are polled, and there is an overwhelming majority for the answer C, which is student is engaged with higher cognitive level activities. So that's great. It basically means that it also, you know, vindicates our point that a flipped classroom session can be run itself, can also be run in flipped mode. So that's the key point that we've been trying to make in this entire session, that it's not simply capturing the video, it's not simply answering doubts in the classroom, it's not simply making sure or re-explaining something to the student in the classroom, but making the student help assimilate by working on higher cognitive levels, which is important in the flipped classroom. And it is clear now about 140 centers have marked that as the key reason. So that's great. Congratulations to all of you. And with that, we will go into the activity or the lab that is there for creating your own flipped classroom now.